Yes, hello, good morning. Thanks a lot for inviting me. Lecture is relativistic simulations for cosmology. And when I say simulations for cosmology, I think mainly in terms of simulations for large scale structure. Of course, you could think simulations, you can also do it for early universe, but this is not going to be the main topic here. So in the first lecture, what I want to talk about is to give you a space-time perspective of n-body simulations in particular. And in the first hands-on, which will be, as I said, tomorrow in the late session, you will have the opportunity to actually apply what you have learned by running your own little simulation. It's of course not as ideal to do this remotely. We are not going to be in the same room. I'll do my best to guide you through the hands-on. What you will need if you want to participate actively and not just look and listen is your own computer with some Unix-like operating system. Linux would be ideal. You can also do it on a Mac. I'll give you some indications as we get there. And then the second lecture will be about how you connect simulations to observations. And this is about how you construct observables on the light cone. This will be relevant more generally also for simulations that don't use the n-body framework. And then in the final and the Friday hands-on, we are going to again try to apply this and do a little analysis of a light cone that we produce with an n-body simulation. So that's more or less the plan. I hope this is fine for everyone. So I was told the usual thing would be to have a little discussion at the end of each lecture. I'm also happy if someone has an urgent question, if I get interrupted. So as you feel is the best. So let's get started. So I hope you can see my mouse. So when we use n-body simulations in cosmology to simulate the evolution of large-scale structures, so what is generally is, you take a bunch of point particles, mass elements, in some volume, give them some initial positions and velocities, and you evolve them forwards in time and see what happens. And cosmology, of course, these initial conditions come from, let's say, linear theory in the early universe. You have some initial perturbations in your particle distribution. You evolve this forward in time, and you get the evolution of large-scale structure out. So while I'm going to, of course, as the title implies, going to talk about relativistic aspects, it's, I think, a good idea to start from proven ground and look at how things are done in a Newtonian context. And of course, these anyway don't exist in isolation. The first thing that Einstein did when he presented his theory of general relativity was to demonstrate how you get the Newtonian limit. So it's I think, a really nice lesson also to learn how the Newtonian simulations are related to the relativistic picture and where this relation could break down. And this will also give you more confidence in where you can actually trust or why you can actually trust Newtonian simulations. So in Newtonian mechanics, you have this first basic equation, Newton's second law, tells you you have a force that gives you a change in the momentum, which is the mass times some acceleration vector, right? And as a cosmologist, I will immediately go into a co-moving coordinate system, so expanding coordinates. And then the equation still looks similar, but there are a few changes. So first of all, this momentum P here is the co-moving momentum. So it's the canonical conjugate of the co-moving position. Then this prime here is a derivative with respect to conformal time. So you do a conformal rescaling of time. I will denote it as tau in this lecture. And the acceleration vector here is given by the peculiar gravitational potential as like the gradient of the potential times the scale factor. So you will see that in this expanding coordinate system, there will be a scale factor popping up here and there, but this is really, otherwise the equations look pretty much the same as you're used to from standard mechanics, let's say. So first note here that in many treatments, you will see no mention of the momentum, but they prefer to rather use the peculiar velocity, which is, of course, in Newtonian mechanics related to the momentum, so this equation. And then you can write the acceleration equation like this. And again, you see that the scale factor appears as this Hubble damping term. But as we will later see, it will be very useful to have this momentum actually in the back of our mind, because it's the more useful quantity in the relativistic setting. So to get this acceleration, so again, we are talking about an n-body system in a cosmological context. So we are looking at very large volumes. The particles are small mass elements in cosmology, meaning small is something like a galaxy or something like that. And the only force that really acts on these very large distances is gravity. So this potential is given by the gravitational, or this force is given by the gravitational force. And the peculiar gravitational potential is computed from this Poisson equation, right? So there are different ways. Sorry, I'm hearing some spurious noise. Thanks. So there are different approaches to solve this n-body dynamics numerically. So for instance, you could use the Green's function method to write a formal solution to this equation 5. And then what you get is you don't even have to compute a potential. You can directly solve equation 1 in terms of two-body forces. Another way, and that is the one that is a bit more relevant for what I'm going to talk about, is that you try to compute this potential. So you discretize your potential field, say on a lattice, and then you also have to discretize the density field on this lattice. And then you approximate this equation 5 by a finite difference equation. So in order to construct this density field from the n-body ensemble that you have to do some kind of particle mesh projection to compute this density field. And then you solve this finite difference equation. Again, different numerical methods to do this. If it's a regular grid, you can do it in Fourier space, for instance, fast Fourier transforms, or you can use a multi-grid algorithm that would also work on adaptive meshes, for instance. So anyway, so you compute this potential, then you can take the discrete gradient version of it and evaluate it at the particle positions to get force interpolation, and then that gives you the particle update. So an n-body simulation then integrates these equations forward in time, given some initial Cauchy data. And each integration step represents the solution at a fixed point in time, right? So this is the general picture. As a example, to be specific, one way is to do this kick drift kick scheme. So you start with a set, a given set of particle positions. From this, you compute the forces, for instance, as I said, by computing the potential. Then, once you have the forces, you update the peculiar velocities. So you use this equation. That's the kick, right? Then you have the updated velocities. You move the particles according to their new velocities. That's the drift step. And then times complete, you start again. You have a new set of particle positions. You again compute forces. You do this kick step again. Okay, so that's more or less how the procedure works in a Newtonian scheme. Are there any urgent questions at this point? Otherwise, let's move to relativistic. So when you think about this picture, right, actually the general relativistic view, I think, follows quite naturally. So instead of just having these time steps telling you what is the configuration of the particles at a certain time, each integration step actually represents the solution on a three-dimensional equal time hypersurface of the four-dimensional spacetime, right? So you promote these constant time hypersurface really hypersurfaces in a curved spacetime. And this comes, of course, with new concepts. So you will have a geometry on this hypersurface, and you will have to think about how it is embedded into the four-dimensional spacetime. So then there are a few questions. So what is actually a good foliation that I should use for this this split of spacetime into hypersurfaces? Under which conditions is the Newtonian treatment a good approximation? And once I have this non-trivial geometry on the hypersurfaces, also like in the embedding, how do I actually interpret the solution that I get out, in particular with regards to observations? So to give you a formal framework to discuss this, let's look at the 3+1 description or formulation of general relativity. And this goes back to Arlovitz and Misner. So you can write any four-dimensional metric in this way, where you introduce a time coordinate that labels the hypersurfaces. So you pick a foliation and you label the hypersurface by this time coordinate tau. And then on each hypersurface, you have some set of coordinates x that labels the points on the hypersurface. And then the metric can always be written like this. So you have these three fields called the lapse function alpha, which essentially tells you something about the distance between the different hypersurfaces, how they are stacked together. Then you have a shift vector beta. This tells you how the points, if you move from one hypersurface to the other, how the points with the same coordinate are connected between hypersurfaces. And then you have this induced metric gamma ij, which is really the metric on the hypersurface, right? So if you set d tau to zero, you see that you end up with the metric on the hypersurface, gamma ij di, the dxi dxj. So these three fields, lapse, shift, and spatial metric, they are, in a sense, new fields that exist on the equal time hypersurfaces. And they play a role similar to the gravitational potential in Newton's second law. So to see this, so you know that massive particles under gravity, they follow the geodesic equation. If you write a geodesic equation, it looks like this. And here, these gradients are still partial derivatives, not covariant or anything, on the hypersurface. And I've already now dropped the assumption that the momentum is small, right? So this is actually the exact geodesic equation for a massive particle, right? In this metric, momentum can be arbitrarily large. So this is more or less what I said. So I've dropped this assumption. And the Newtonian limit, you can quite easily see. So if you take p square much smaller than m square, you can more or less forget about this term. And then depending on, so if you have also weak fields, then this term, of course, is small. And this term is small as well, because there are always these p factors. So you end up with something like this, which is very similar to what we had up here, right? Okay. So, but again, in full generality, the relation between the co-moving momentum and the peculiar velocity looks like this. And this just comes from solving the canonical momentum, the velocity for the canonical momentum for the velocity. Anyway, so what you can also see is that using the momentum as a variable actually makes the equations relatively straightforward. I mean, they are still like the square roots and so on, but still, if you would try to write an equation for v prime instead of using p, you would end up with the right mess, right? Take the time derivative of this and then insert this. It becomes very complicated in general. Okay, so using this geodesic equation, the kick drift kick scheme I mentioned earlier generalizes in the following way. So given a solution for the lapse, the shift, and the metric, which we will discuss later, the kick step would use equation 7. So you update the momentum using this. As I said, you already know alpha, beta, and gamma. And the drift step would use equation 9. So you, from your momentum, you compute the peculiar velocity. That gives you, of course, the distance the particle moves per time interval. You can do the particle update. Okay. So, now let's discuss how do we get to these to the solutions of these functions alpha, beta, and gamma. So first of all, the metric has to obey the Hamiltonian constraint, which is the time component of Einstein's equation on the hypersurface, which in full generality looks like this, right? So here, this 3R is the Ricci curvature scalar of gamma. So it's on the curvature of the intrinsic curvature of the hypersurface. And then you have this contribution from the extrinsic curvature. The extrinsic curvature tensor tells you how the hypersurface is embedded into the four-dimensional space-time, and it's connected to the metric variables in this way. So here this di is a covariant derivative on the hypersurface. Note that here this rho on the right-hand side is defined as the projection of the stress energy onto the unit normal of the hypersurface, and should not be confused with the density in the fluid rest frame, unless you, I mean, you, of course, your hypersurface could be aligned such that the fluid is at rest in this hypersurface, but this is not generally the case. So that, there can be a difference in because the density is frame dependent, right? So here, what is really meant is the one that you get from this projection. And we are still free to choose our foliation. So to choose the time coordinate, and we are also free to choose the coordinate functions on the hypersurface. And no matter what choice we do, this equation still remains true. So let's look at the first example for a choice. Because of this freedom to choose these things, we can actually try to go into a coordinate system where alpha has a certain form and beta, which is a vector, we can also set to something just by using the freedom to choose the coordinate functions. So this is a very popular choice in perturbation theory, for instance. So here you are actually putting yourself into, let's say you have a cold dark matter fluid, and you go into the rest frame of this fluid. This is what you get. So you have the Laplace function is just the scale factor, the shift vector you can set to zero. And if you do this, you can see that the momentum equals zero is a trivial solution to the geodesic equation, right? So go here, the gradient of alpha vanishes. So if I set p to zero, it stays zero. The solution of the n-body dynamics in this coordinate system would be trivial. You don't have to do anything. But of course, there's no free lunch, right? So you will have all the actual dynamics of the matter will be incorporated into the coordinate chart. So that means that the particles in this coordinate system don't change the coordinates of the particles in this coordinate system don't change, but the proper distance, of course, between them still changes. So that means you have to change this spatial metric, and actually it changes by a lot. So it becomes actually non-perturbative quite quickly because the particle configuration becomes non-perturbative. So this is, by the way, the point of doing a simulation. If you are always in a perturbative regime, you don't need a simulation, right? So you do a simulation because you want to do a non-perturbative calculation. So what happens is that the particles in actuality, they of course, you will have them form structure, you will have matter streams crossing and so on. So as soon as this happens, this is not even a good coordinate choice anymore, right? The metric becomes ill-defined once the particle orbits cross, because you can't assign like the coordinate system like becomes multi-valued, right? It's not a one-to-one correspondence between space-time events and coordinates anymore. While, as I said, that particle dynamics more or less is integrated out, you have this complicated gamma, and that also makes your relation between the solution and observations quite obscured, because you have this very complicated spatial metric, and that means that if you look at how photons travel through the space-time, they, of course, their solution is completely non-trivial. So if you go back here, so for photons, you take the limit mass goes to zero, you will see that these two terms still go away by our gauge choice, but this term, right, mass goes to zero, the gamma is still there, right? And the photons really see the gradient of this gamma, and this gradient is large. So they really don't go along straight lines in this coordinate system. So your intuition about what an observer would see is completely lost, I would say. However, just empirically we know, or it's evident that there should be charts where the photons do travel almost along straight lines, right? Because this is just our everyday experience. We take pictures of the our telescopes of the universe, and we don't see everything like completely distorted and messed up. So like the zeros order approximation that photons just go along straight lines seems to be kind of not completely unreasonable. So in order to have such a chart, again, as you can see from this equation, taking the mass zero, as I said, to see what happens to photons, you want that all these gradients are small, so that actually the photons stay more or less on a straight path. So such a situation I shall call weak field gravity. And just to warm up, let's go to the linear regime, because there this has of course been extensively studied. Linear cosmological perturbation theory is hopefully a topic many of you have been in contact with before. So here, again, in full generality, what you do is you go to a linearly perturbed Friedmann metric. So the Laplace function in this case is scale factor times 1 plus some Laplace perturbation A. The shift vector, again, can be written for convenience here, we decompose it into a gradient part and a curl part. So this BI vector here should have no divergence. And this is useful because we are in linear theory, and in linear theory, if you decompose vectors, or anyway, tensors into scalar vectors and tensors, these different modes don't couple, right? So you can look at the scalar sector separately and vector sector separately and so on. Finally, the three metric, so of course, because it's a tensor, it's a bit more complicated. It's again A times, you first do a perturbation of the trace called HL. And then you have also a scalar trace free perturbation. You can write it like this. If you take the trace of this, vanishes. And then you can also have a vector perturbation again. Use the gauge condition that this doesn't have a divergence. And then there is a pure tensor perturbation as well, which, for instance, would contain the spin two field of gravitational waves. And this is transverse and traceless. So taking the gradient, it vanishes, taking the trace, zero. Okay, so again, let me remind you that we have this freedom to choose our coordinate system. So we have a time coordinate that we can choose, which is a scalar freedom of choice, let's say. And you also choose the coordinate functions on the hypersurfaces. So that's effectively a three vector reverse of choice, which you can decompose into longitudinal and the transverse part. So you have two scalars and one transverse vector in your freedom of the coordinate choice. So you can use this to set two of the scalars that we have, so the lapse perturbation, the scalar, like the gradient part of the shift, trace perturbation and the trace free perturbation. So two of them we can set to arbitrary functions, and also one of the transverse vectors, because of the coordinate choice, right? We can choose one of the transverse vectors to be an arbitrary function. So they're not all independent. So now let's make contact to the Newtonian limit. This is really what I want to discuss in this part of the presentation. So in the Newtonian case, we forget about this vector and tensor modes. They don't exist really strictly in the Newtonian gravity. So we only have scalar modes. And now we want to see how we recover the Newtonian limit. So let's write the Hamiltonian constraints. And just to remind you, this is the Hamiltonian constraint. Now we use the metric that we have, parametrization that we have written down, and just calculate what is the Ricci, what is the extrinsic curvature, and so on. And we end up with this equation. And I should tell you what I mean with delta rho. So delta rho is defined, as you would expect, as rho minus rho bar. And the rho bar that you use, right, that's what I'm always going to use, is the thing that enters the Friedmann equation, which gives you A, right? So to be consistent, right? Because on the left-hand side, actually, you have somewhere you have a background term, H square, right? And I subtracted this term. And on the right-hand side, I subtracted this rho bar. So you just have to make sure that you subtract the same thing on both sides, and then everything's fine. Okay. So now how to compute this delta rho for an n-body ensemble. To compute the density, you actually need to know what the metric is. And so this is this. You can see, for instance, if you write down the density given by a classical point particle, right? So you have a delta function, of course, because it's a point particle, but then you have this relativistic energy, and then you have this volume factor, right? So you need to know what is the physical volume per coordinate volume, if you want, on your hypersurface. So you need to know this gamma. And this is the determinant of the metric, by the way. So again, because we want to discuss the Newtonian limit, let's go to the limit where the momentum is very small. This is true always, but again, let's go to the Newtonian case. And then you see, okay, you can forget about this part, but you compute the determinant of the metric, and you see that you get this VHL factor here. And here, just for a bit of convenience, I have introduced N, which is like a number count or number density in coordinate space. So this is nothing physical. It's really, you take a small volume in your chart, let's say. So you have a really, take just a coordinate volume, ignoring the fact that there is a metric that tells you how big this volume is physically, and you count the numbers of particles in there, right? And then you also have like the mean number of particles in the whole simulation per coordinate volume. This is this n bar, and so this this gives you the this essentially accounts for the Masters rho bar, and then you end up with this expression. So this tells you how the volume enters, right, to the physical volume. Is it a relation between the physical volume and the coordinate volume? All right, so that's for the right-hand side. Now, let's also look at the geodesic equation in this limit, p squared much smaller than m squared. So what we do is we take this equation and this equation and go, well, we know what, like a parametrization of alpha, beta, and gamma, insert it, and we take the limit p squared much smaller than m squared. And you can verify that you end up with this kind of acceleration equation, right? V prime plus hv equal gradient of this. So, just to remind you again, we had, of course, what a Newtonian code solves is this equation, so the gradient of this Newtonian potential, whatever, on the right-hand side. So we should, to recover the Newtonian limit, we should have that this phi in the simulation is essentially this, right? This combination of metric potentials. Then, of course, you have not only the Hamiltonian constraint, but you have more parts of Einstein's equation that you can use. And one that is quite useful to look at is the tracery part of the space-based component of Einstein's equation. And that has a scalar part in it. And so if you don't have anisotropic stress, and the anisotropic stress of cold dark matter is very, very small, so it's a very good approximation to neglect it, because it's essentially a velocity square term. Perturbation theory, you just neglect quadratic terms. That implies that, so maybe you remember from your cosmology course that you have these two Bardeen potentials, and they are equal if you have no anisotropic stress. This is essentially this equation. So with this additional equation in mind, you can rearrange it. I've done this so that you have this combination that appears here on the left-hand side. And here on the right-hand side, you have a combination of terms that appear in the Hamiltonian constraint. So you insert this in the Hamiltonian constraint, and just show it again. All right, so these three terms appear exactly like this. There's this one, and this one on the left-hand side. So you insert this in the Hamiltonian constraint, you end up with this equation. So you see again here Laplace of what is going to be our potential, and then you have a bunch of additional terms. And then the right-hand side, so as we already said, this is rho, right? And then you subtract rho bar, this is minus one. It's important to point out here that all I have done is I assumed that the metric perturbations are small, right? So I never have to assume anywhere that this is small, this n over n. So you can have large density fluctuations. We are not doing full perturbation theory in this sense, right? So it's only perturbative in the metric. Okay, so this is the equation you end up with, and as we already saw earlier, what a Newtonian code solves is something. So you have the Laplace of this phi in the simulation is 4 pi g a square delta rho, and how the delta rho internally is computed in the Newtonian code is, of course, you forget about the fact that you have a volume perturbation, right? You don't know, this showing code just takes the coordinate volume and that's it, right? So you don't have this term. So this is what you have. So now we can quite easily figure out what is the condition that the Newtonian approximation works. And the first case is probably the one everyone thinks of initially, is in terms of the Newtonian gauge. The Newtonian gauge is when you use your coordinate freedom, we already discussed, right? So you can choose your coordinates such that there is no gradient part of the shift, and there's also no trace, like scalar trace-free part of the metric three metric perturbations. You set these two to zero. So you immediately see that from, let's say, this equation, or this equation, but that because you set B to zero, that the potential is encoded in the lapse perturbation, right? Then you can also look at, this equation. And so this term goes away, this term set to zero, this one is set to zero, they are all set to zero. So we have HL plus A equals zero, because A is the potential, so HL is minus the potential, right? This is what you immediately see. But now if you insert this into the Hamiltonian constraint, so you have to, here you have the Laplace of the potential, and so this term here goes away, but you're left with these terms, and you're left with this term. They don't go away, right? So this equation 23 is not the same as equation 22, strictly speaking. It is only a good approximation to equation 22 if on the left-hand side you have that this Laplace of phi, right, is much larger than these spurious terms, right, which you can write now as this. And also, if on the right-hand side, this term, right, is much larger than the term that you have dropped, right, which is this. Okay? So both conditions are generally met if you are on scales much smaller than the homogeneity scale. This is because the difference, the density contrast is at least a percent or so, let's say, or it can become order unity easily in cosmology, and the potential is 10 to the minus 5, right? So it is true that if unless you are on scales where the number count perturbation is very, very small, close to 10 to the minus 5, you can more or less forget about this term, right? You might get worried a bit early, but let's say if it's 10 to the minus 4, then you have a 10% correction. You might get worried at this point. But yeah, density contrast of 10 to the minus 4, you have to go to very large scale. Same is true on the left-hand side. So these terms, you can think of it in Fourier space, right? So if you go to Fourier space, this becomes the k squared, and then you compare more or less k squared to h squared or something like that, right? So as long as your wavelength or wave number you're looking at is much smaller than much larger than the inverse of the Hubble, whatever. So you're looking at small scales much smaller than the Hubble scale, then this will be true. Okay. So that said, of course, once we go to extremely large scales, this is no longer a good gauge to think of if you are using a Newtonian simulation, right? So let's look at what other choices we could do. And one interesting one I want to point out is this one. So you can, of course, use your gauge freedom to set HL to zero. So this term on the right-hand side goes away. And then also, of course, this term goes away. And now the term that is still annoying you is this together with this. But you can set them, you can set this to zero by using this gauge choice. So now, actually, you have you are in a situation where the right-hand side is exactly this one, the left-hand side is exactly this one. So perfect, right? This is great. So this really works well on very large scales. It's called, by the way, the n-body gauge. I introduced it here slightly differently than it was originally introduced, but essentially, what you do is you end up with the n-body gauge if you do this. On large scales, this works perfectly. The gauge condition is a bit unusual, so you won't find this in all textbooks, and it's kind of a new concept to use this gauge, right? So people have looked at this. So it turns out that if you look how the metric perturbations behave in this gauge after the radiation matter transition, the lapse perturbation goes to zero, and this HT goes to a constant unequal zero. It's unusual this gauge is a bit unintuitive because you have this trace-free perturbation of the spatial metric that is somehow important on very large scales. A little bit of drawback of this choice is that this potential B becomes relatively large. It's not catastrophically large as in the let's say what you would have in the synchronous gauge, but it's still large enough that you might be worried a little bit about the weak field assumption as you go to very small scales. But then again, on very small scales, this interpretation works. So you can think of on large scales in body simulations, you can think of being in this gauge. And as you go to small scales, maybe it's not so great to use this gauge. Generally speaking, however, you can use your gauge freedom to find a whole family of gauges where the Newtonian equations of motion are correct. And these are called Newtonian motion gauges. And some of them will have the weak field assumption all the way to small scales. They typically have this HT unequal zero on large scales. So that makes them a little bit unusual, right? If you want to compute observables in the end. So anyway, I think this is very interesting to see that you can get a space-time metric on which the Newtonian dynamics makes sense on very large scales. It's not the case for the Newtonian gauge. So maybe this is a good point to ask for questions, because I'm now going to the final part of my talk. Are there any questions on this Newtonian discussion?
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Can you include a cosmological constant in your formalism?
Sure. Yes. There's no. I didn't. So a cosmological constant, of course, doesn't produce a gravitational field, right? So what happens is that you have more or less an additional contribution. So this row bar here, of course, is only the row bar of the matter, but you can have to the full row, let's say you can have a cosmological constant contribution, which you would again subtract if you compute this delta row. And it enters also in the H, right? So you still have subtracted the same thing on both sides. And maybe I didn't say this at any point, but having a cosmological constant doesn't change anything here. It's a trivial change, both in the Newtonian as in the case here, in the relativistic case.
Thank you.
Okay, so then let's move on. So now I'll go away from this linear weak field gravity discussion and discuss the final framework that I actually want to go to. And this is using Poisson gauge, which is kind of the cosmologist's choice. If you look at how, like, it's very useful in cosmological perturbation theory, like one of the favorite gauges there. It's used in lensing calculations and so on. So it's a widely used gauge. And the reason why it is so good or so useful is precisely because it is a weak field gauge choice. So in some sense, you can think of it as instead of going into the rest frame of the matter, which is kind of giving you a very complicated metric in the end, you're trying to go into the rest frame of the gravitational field. So that's how, for instance, you would describe the solar system or something like that. So you don't want to necessarily go into a system of infalling particles or whatever. You just take something that stays the same all the time. The gravitational field stays constant all the time. And that makes the computation much simpler. And anyway, so what you have in Poisson gauge is you write the Laplace function like this. So you have this first gravitational potential psi, the Laplace. Then I'll allow for a divergence less part of the spin to remain. So I've removed the vector part of the gamma ij, but I can't, by gauge choice, remove it from beta. That's where it is. And then in the spatial metric, again, I have a trace perturbation, if you want, and I have this spin two field perturbation. So gate freedom was used to remove the vector part of gamma ij. The scalar part of beta I, and then this trace free scalar part of gamma ij. Okay, so this is just to get some intuition, this beta I or BI in this notation is the gravitomagnetic potential, which is responsible for frame dragging. This HIJ, of course, is the tensor perturbation, which you would get, for instance, from gravitational waves. And then you have these two scalar gravitational potentials in principle. So what I will now do in the following is that for this BI and this HIJ, I will still linearize my equations. And this is because these are really, really small effects in all practical circumstances, right? So we know they are orders of magnitude smaller than the gravitational potentials. So I will only keep them if they are multiplied with background terms. But for phi and psi, actually keeping them like this in the exponential, non-perturbatively, you could linearize them as well, but we don't need to. And actually, the equations look nicer if you use this exponential. So I'll just keep them non-perturbatively. Another upshot of this is that if you use this in a situation where you know that B and HIJ vanish. For instance, you look at spherical collapse, and you know by symmetry that they have to vanish. You end up with exact equations. Right? So you have to do no approximation. So that's great. So that said, with this prescription, I can compute the determinant of the metric. HIJ only would give higher order terms, which I neglect, so I end up with this simple expression. I compute the Hamiltonian constraint and end up with this expression. And now again, I want to tell you how you compute rho in full generality. So if you have an n-body ensemble, particles, it's arbitrary momentum, it works out like this. So you, I've written it in this way, just for convenience. So you have the relativistic energy here. You see, so this pointy bracket means you take the average of this expression over all particles in your infinitesimal volume where you want to compute rho, right? So because there could be many particles, they have some kind of momentum distribution. So this is the mean over the momentum distribution of the particles, let's say. And you have this volume perturbation, and here I have to put the rest mass density because everything beyond that is already included in here. So I should distinguish this from rho bar that enters the Friedmann equation, because if I for instance have a species that has a, let's say for instance neutrinos is a good example, take massive neutrinos, they have a momentum distribution that contributes to their energy density and even to the mean, like the global mean of the all of space-time, the mean of this doesn't go away, right? But it's included in this mean, so I put here the rest. This is not the same as the rho bar then, right? So the rho bar that I put into the Friedmann equation would be the one that actually includes this mean. Okay, I hope this was clear. Anyway. So now, okay, I have this equation, I have a way to compute this rho. So now let's say we want to truncate this equation 28 at a certain level of precision, and I just pick order 5. 5 is typically order 10 to minus 5. So I'll say, yeah, I want this equation to be accurate to relative precision of 10 to minus 5. So if non-relativistic matter is the dominant source of gravitational fields, you can make a few back of the envelope estimates. First of all, just from the, let's say the Newtonian thinking, you can see that Laplace phi over h square is similar to delta rho or rho bar, which is something that can become large. So this is something that I think is order one, could be order one, let's say. Then phi prime is something similar to h times phi, right? This changes slowly in time. Then velocity square actually interestingly is similar to linear phi, right? And we can get this, for instance, thinking about the Virial limit where kinetic energy and potential energy are related. And then finally, also the gradient of phi times, let's say, the Hubble time is similar to the velocity order of magnitude, right? Because the velocity is given, I mean, the gradient of phi acts over the Hubble time and gives you a velocity, so they kind of work out this way. So now using this and saying I want to be at order phi in the end, and truncating everything consistently, you end up with this equation, right? So you see that because you want to go order phi, you have a velocity square term which is the same of order phi. You also have this gradient, because gradient is again similar to a velocity gradient square term here. And you have this phi plus phi because this is order one. Okay. Okay. So this would be my first equation that I could put into my computer. Next, I need, of course, a way to solve for all the fields. So I have, at the moment, I have just one equation. I have two scalars, phi and psi, and I have the vector perturbation and the tensor perturbation to solve. So I need additional equations. So let's first look at the second scalar equation. So we know that the difference between the potentials is going to be small unless you have large anisotropic stress, which I'm not going to assume here. So it's kind of fair to treat this difference again perturbatively, let's say, right? So I treat it on the same footing as B or HIJ. And then I can just work out from the space-based part of the Einstein equation, I get a constraint which looks like this. So interestingly, again, truncating consistently, I have these two gradients here. They were actually on the left-hand side, but I moved them to the right-hand side. For the n-body ensemble, this relativistic shear stress, again, you can compute by an average over a moment of the momentum distribution of the particles. And in the non-relativistic limits, it's easy to think of this as rho times the IVJ average. So adding this term, actually, if you want to compute phi minus psi, is important because it is literally of the same order as this, right? So if you would have just said, okay, phi minus psi is anisotropic stress of matter, and use this as the anisotropic stress of matter, you would make a 100% mistake because you've missed this term, which is of the same order. Then let's quickly go to the last two potentials. So you have the frame dragging potential, which you get from the momentum constraint. You just project out the vector part of the momentum constraint. This again, the momentum density of the n-body ensemble. It's easy to compute from the momentum distribution. And finally, for the tensor perturbation, you get like, okay, you have to project out the trace-free transverse part of this expression. And okay, this is just how the projection looks like in real space. But that's all that there is. So you have your wave equation that is sourced by this spin two part, let's say, of this expression. So now we've got everything. We know how to compute the metric. This last equation contains the propagating degrees of freedom of general relativity that actually make the treatment of GR so complicated, let's say, if you do it in a let's say numerical relativity framework. But using the scalar vector tensor decomposition that we employed here in this Poisson cage actually allows us to extract this part. So this is really the only thing that has this second time derivative. And for structure formation, this HIJ really doesn't play a role. So we see that in our approximation where we linearize in this HIJ, it actually never really appears. So we can either throw away this equation completely and do your structure formation simulation without ever computing HIJ, or we can at least do some kind of approximation for this equation I don't really have much time left. What you can do is you realize that this right-hand side, if it's just from ordinary matter, right, varies very slowly in time. You can see from this equation. At least if you're in perturbation theory, rho goes down like a cubed, you have an a square factor, and velocity grows like square root of a, so actually it's constant in time, right? In perturbation theory, first order perturbation theory. Same is true for this term, because phi doesn't, at least in matter domination, phi doesn't change. Argument also matter domination. So you have something that doesn't change in time. On the right hand side, on the left hand side, you have a harmonic oscillator, damped harmonic oscillator. So all that happens is that this damped harmonic oscillator will approach a new equilibrium point and then just stay there, right? Where this term is equal to this term, right? So you can just insert this this limiting solution, and it's going to be an extremely good approximation, right? Because this changes extremely slowly. So this is what we do. So now we can take a look at the solutions. Here I show dimensionless power spectra for the different metric perturbations in lambda CDN. So the largest one is phi, right? The gravitational potential. These are different redshifts. So you see at redshift 3, this dashed line is first linear perturbation theory. You're almost on the linear perturbation theory solution. The colored lines are from full simulations, right? So yes, you go to lower redshift, you will see that there is a little bit of nonlinear clustering that produces additional power in the gravitational field. Then the next biggest contribution is the frame dragging potential. It's down by 4 or 5 orders of magnitude in the power spectrum. So in terms of actual real space amplitude, let's say, it's about 2.5 orders of magnitude, roughly speaking, because you have this is a quadratic quantity. So it's a sub-percent, like roughly a bit smaller than a percent correction to the metric, if you want. And then the other two that are sourced by the shear stress, they are even smaller, right? So you see that they are like really, really way down, the phi minus psi and the tensor perturbations. But they also get some nonlinear enhancement, of course, you know, very small scale.
Julian, yes. You have 15 minutes left.
Excellent, okay. So
including the discussion.
Including the discussion, so I will wrap up. I'll just show a few nice pictures quickly. So this is just a visualization in the simulation. On the left, you see a visualization. So these dots are little halos and so on, and you see a visualization of the gravitomagnetic potential, which is shown in the streamlines, and you can see a little bit how it is correlated with the structure. And on the right, this is a different simulation, so it's not really the same snapshot anyway. And I've tried to visualize what a tensor mode looks like that is produced by the large-scale structure. So this brings me to the summary of my first lecture. First of all, we've seen that the n-body dynamics in Poisson gauge differ from Jordan dynamics on large scales, even in lambda CDM. However, Poisson gauge is a very useful gauge to work with because it has it ensures the weak field conditions for the metric, which will make an interpretation easier, though not completely trivial. I'll have an entire lecture on how we interpret the output of these simulations in terms of observations. The nice thing is that I have to assume the Newtonian limits. So the right hand side of all these equations that I've written here, I've always given you the expression that comes from the n-body ensemble, but you are free to add other things here, of course, right? So you can use your favorite, I don't know, dark energy model, weird dark matter model, coupled dark matter, dark energy, or whatever. As long as you can compute the stress energy tensor, you just plug it in on the right-hand side, right? Plug in here the rho that you get out, plug in here the Tij, T0j. And you still solve the metric. And once you have the metric, you know how the particles move, if there are particles in the simulation. Also, using this gauge, this hyperbolic nature of general relativity doesn't immediately jeopardize the performance. I just alluded to this in the end. So if you do full numerical GR simulations, you often don't do this vector tensor scalar decomposition, and then you have to actually follow the oscillations of the gravitational waves on all scales to get a stable evolution. But since this is kind of separated off, we can deal with this problem differently, and we can actually do very efficient simulations for structure formation without problem. Final point is that. Of course, the Poisson gauge is not the only useful gauge you could use. The Newtonian motion gauges are extremely useful if you want to use the Newtonian code and interpret it on very large scales. In any case, the interpretation of the output on very large scales is subtle. And I will talk about this for the second lecture. So hope you're I'll fire up for that. Some further reading is here. So that's it, and we can start a discussion if you like.
Okay, thank you very much for your first course. And I will take now questions from people. So I don't see any question on the public discussion. Has anyone a question to ask? So just unmute your microphone.
Hi, Julian. I maybe have a question. I mean, okay. Same question as Thomas. He asked you whether actually you take into account cosmological constants. And you say that cosmological constants disappear, probably in the time term, right? Why you say the cosmological constant disappear? I mean, I don't understand. Because you induce the effect of cosmological constant in the background, and that's it?
Yes, so of course, it doesn't disappear. It disappears from the perturbation equations. But it is, of course, in the... I haven't written the Friedmann equation anywhere here, but it is in the Friedmann equation, of course.
The Friedmann equation. So yes, you take into account in the chronology.
Yes, so this A, this appears here everywhere. This, of course, you have to put a solution for this A.
Yeah.
And the solution comes from... I mean, you can see it from this equation, right? Let me discuss it from the point of view of this. Because here I haven't subtracted the cosmological constant yet. Here's rho on the right-hand side, right?
Okay.
But you see that if you see there is this 3/2 h square term.
Mm-hmm.
This is a background term.
Yeah.
And if I subtract this term from this equation, and I use Friedmann equation, then the cosmological constant disappears from the right hand side.
Mm. Yes, for sure.
Yeah. And that's all you do. So you take this equation, but you solve the background part separately. You say I get a solution for H, I use some rho bar to get this h, right? This rho bar includes the cosmological constant. And then I subtract this h squared term on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side. And once I use the Friedmann equation, the lambda has disappeared from the perturbation equation.
From the perturbation equation. Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Are there other questions?
Yes, I would like to ask where I can download your PDF file, please.
Excellent question. I don't think you can do it yet. I'm still working on the second lecture, finalizing a few little details. I think we should make it available at the end of the week.
Yes.
I don't know if the organizers have any
clue
how to do it.
Exactly. You just sent to me, and then I will provide to all participants your PDF. But just to remind you, you have 4 slots, not 3, 4 slots.
Yes.
One each day.
Yes, I know. But it's 2 lectures and 2 hands-on sessions.
Exactly.
So we'll just to repeat. So this was the first lecture. Tomorrow we'll have a first hands-on.
That will use
more or less what we learned today a little bit, let's say. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then on Thursday we'll have the second lecture, and on Friday finally we'll have a second hands-on that uses what we've learned in the second lecture. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, perfect.
It would be helpful to have your PDF file of this lecture to prepare tomorrow.
Yes.
Okay.
For me, it's fine. Can we share it somehow?
Just send to me, mm-hmm. and I will put is a comment, you know, website, and then people as abstract, and then all people can be retrieved. Okay, that's it.
Okay. I don't see other questions, so I'd like to ask you if all the setup that you present is valid in the domain of validity. I understand that it is valid in the matter-dominated era. But then, how would you connect this formalism to the radiation-dominated era? That would be... one question. And also, in the matter-dominated era, you could use just a Newtonian model. Suppose that I neglect all the vector and tensor perturbations. Then, what would be the difference between your framework, say in the Newtonian gauge, and the prediction from the Newtonian cosmology, you know, Milne-McCrae approach to just the Newtonian cosmology of Milne and McCrae, what would be the difference? Would I have different in the scalar perturbations as well? That would, if I just do my perturbation using the Newtonian cosmology.
Yes, so there are 2 parts of your question. So let me start with the first one. You asked about radiation era. I've never really assumed matter domination here, but just gave examples for the stress energy of an n-body ensemble here, right? So there are a few complications in the radiation era that come from the fact that you have baryons, right? And baryons, in the radiation era, they are strongly coupled to photons, so they don't travel on geodesics for massive particles. That would be the complication, right? So you don't just have this equation, but you would have another force that comes from the coupling to the radiation. If you know how to include this, I think you're still fine. You have to include, of course, radiation perturbations in your stress energy tensor. It's going to be an ambitious thing to do. We haven't done this, of course, but what we have done is we used. If you are after the end of radiation domination, so after decoupling, or let's even say after a baryon drag, so baryons are decoupled from photons, you still have radiation floating around, right? It has, on extremely large scales, it still has some, let's say, a redshift 200 or something like that. Radiation is still considerable contribution to the stress energy. So the perturbations in the photons actually matter, and you can include them. So we have included this. There's an entire paper about this, how this is done. You can also do it in the Newtonian code, because, as I explained, you have this Newtonian motion gauges, and you can work out what the photons do in this gauge and then include it in the Newtonian treatment. So this is, I think, one of the upshots of this, also this Newtonian discussion, which brings me to your second question about the Newtonian treatment. And in lambda CDM, the Newtonian treatment works really, really well. So, I mean, this was a bit of the point of this Newtonian discussion, to see why it works so well and where it can potentially break down. So on small scales, I see absolutely no problem in lambda CDM to use the Newtonian treatment, because this this condition is always fulfilled. And also interpreting in terms of the Poisson or the Newtonian gauge on small scales works absolutely fine. It's just on very large scales, if this condition is no longer met, that you cannot use the Newtonian gauge to interpret your Newtonian simulation. So you have to use a different gauge. You can use the n-body gauge, no problem with that. You will still get consistent interpretation that is founded in GR, but it is an unusual gauge. So you have to know how to deal with it. That's all, right? But apart from that,
okay.
Yes.
If I neglect vector and tensor perturbations.
Yes. And I think, I mean, in lambda CDM, unless you are specifically interested in them for some reason, for large scale structure, they have a negligible role. So it's fine to neglect them. Yeah.
Okay. If I don't see another question from the public discussion, and since we have 2 minutes left, I will have another remark for you. And I wonder what is your comment on that. So this is trivial remark. Is that in all this formalism, you completely neglect the back reaction on the metric. On the, you have a fixed cosmological background, and the self or the gravity of the particles does not modify the background, if I understand correctly.
Ah, no. So this is an interesting remark. It could take me longer than 2 minutes to explain in detail, but let me quickly go back to maybe. So first of all, not all what I said is background dependent. So for instance, this, so you, if you accept that you can do a foliation of your space-time, right? So there, in this alpha, gamma, beta, whatever, you don't have to do a split between background and perturbations. You can do this always, right? This is what numerical relativists do. This is also always true, right? So to answer a bit more to your point is, so again, I've written my metric like this, and here kind of said these are perturbations to FRW, but you see that your scale factor A is a kind of a nuisance parameter here, because you can always absorb, if I change the definition of A, I can absorb it into the definition of phi, B, and psi, right? So the A is a redundant parameter that I just introduced for computational convenience. It has no physical significance, if you want, right? So you could remove it and just add give you a constant contribution, let's say, to the phi and to the psi, and rescale your B in some way. So that would be the answer to my question. So to your question, the computational relevance of this A comes when I subtract this background, and I do it consistently, right? So I just subtract a function that I choose arbitrarily. It doesn't have to have any physical meaning from both sides of this equation. This function, so I just choose a function A that gives me an H, and I subtract the same side thing on the other side. And I just, in order to, for this to work, I have to choose it so that whatever remains can be solved stably numerically. Back reaction is completely included in this framework, in my opinion. There's no background dependence.
Yes, but when you perform your simulations, your particles are point particles, and you just you don't need any regularization to remove the self field of the particles. So you just ignore the self field of the particles. When you compute the acceleration of a particle, you have the gradient of the field, and you take the gradient of the field at the location of the particle. And so in principle, this is divergent, but you ignore completely that. So you don't need any regularization.
I mean the back reaction of the particle on itself.
Yes, yes.
I see, okay.
On the background. So in that, but this is, I think this is quite obvious in your... Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure I understood your question completely, but maybe we should continue discuss. I don't want to take time from my following.
No, just to say that the motion of the particles is a geodesic motion. You don't have deviation from the geodesic motion due to the presence of the particle itself. So in this sense, you neglect the self force acting on the particle due to the presence of the particle itself. But this is, I think, quite obvious.
Okay. So I kind of missed your point a little bit, but yeah, sorry. Yeah.